Chautauqua County-headquartered Howard Hannah Holt Real Estate offers comprehensive residential and commercial real estate sales, leasing and related services, including real property appraisals, property management, development services, vacation property rentals, and traditional rentals. Westfield Memorial Hospital provides high-quality health care to residents of Western New York, offering patients the most sophisticated medical advancements while keeping the ease and familiarity of a community hospital. Support for Chautauqua Sunrise has been provided by WRFA 107.9 FM, Jamestown's public radio station, streaming online 24/7 at WRFALP.com. Low power to the people. Funding is provided by a grant from New York State Senator Catherine M. Young, representing Western New York's 57th District with a local office in Olean. Chautauqua Sunrise is made possible by a grant from Fredonia Place, a continuing care retirement community providing dignity in a modern luxury environment. Meter's Restaurant, a family tradition for over 50 years in downtown Ripley, is a proud supporter of Chautauqua Sunrise. Meter's provides all-day dining, banquet services, and custom catering, specializing in pie. From the Access Channel 5 studios in Mayville, it's Chautauqua Sunrise. Chautauqua Sunrise is hosted by Doc Hamels and supported by the award-winning volunteers at Access Channel 5. Continuing the traditions of Senior Report, we are here to share local news, colorful interviews, and events of interest to everyone. Chautauqua Sunrise is broadcast live Saturday mornings each week, countywide, from 9 to 10 a.m. Join us by calling in live, emailing us, or checking out our social media. And now, from the Channel 5 studios, it's Chautauqua Sunrise.
Hey, happy Saturday, everybody. I'm Doc Hamels. If you just joined us for the first time, this is Chautauqua Sunrise. From time to time, I like to remind you that this show is really for you. This show is about Chautauqua County, the good things that are going on, interesting things. Hopefully, people tell me it's interesting because of the guests that we bring on. And today is, with no exception, is going to be so cool. It's going to be lots of fun. My guest is energized, and I'm not going to tell you about it all yet. But we're really going to go into some history and some good stuff here on the show. As always, I like to remind you, and I know many of you watch the show later on in the week. Many of you listen to us on WRFA 107.9, low power to the people, on Tuesdays at 1 o'clock. And some of you watch us throughout the week at various times in Jamestown, Fredonia, and so forth, and you can't call in. But if you do want to call in during the show, we're live Saturday mornings from 9 to 10. Give us a call at 753-5225. You can email us if you have a question, a comment. I encourage folks to send us their organization's activities and fundraisers and things like that, because lots of times what's going on in one part of the county, you never hear about it. So we're sort of like in the middle here, right here in Mayville. We're the vortex, if you will. We know that, and it's been proven time and time again, and we're happy to do that. And it's all for you guys. It really is. And people say, well, how do you get up Saturday mornings every week? It's just fun. And the feedback that we've gotten from all of you over the years now is what keeps us going. I was checking the stats the other day, and we're almost at 8,000 views on YouTube. So, I mean, we know you're watching this. We know that you're interested, and we thank you. So with that, just remember, if you have a birthday, a celebration, anything, it doesn't matter. It's just fun, and we're sharing that with the rest of the county. Okay, I have some things to share with you today, and then we'll get to our guest, as we always do. So I don't know where I want to start. Let's just start with some announcements. And oh, no, I have some other things. I see what I got here. I have some things I want to talk about. So where were you Thursday during the rain? I was talking about this before we went on the air. Wow, the weather has been nuts out here. I mean, usually this time of year, we got a foot of snow. We're all grumbling about how cold it is. And then we get like 10 inches of rain. I was out in Russell, Pennsylvania on Thursday. I could not get to Russell two different ways. I had to come up with a third alternative. I ended up in Chandler's Valley. I don't even know what state I was. I think I was in West Virginia at that point. And I had this cab looping around. Thank goodness I had my iPhone for a GPS. Well, I got to where I needed to get to, but it was hard to believe. Two roads were flooded. On the way back, my partner, my musical partner, Will Russell, and I were talking. I said, well, I can't go back the way I came. I don't think I can get home. So he says, go up 62 to 60. So I get up there. It's flooded. The Conowongo or whatever it is right there, that river was just took over the whole stretch. I don't think I was even within a half a mile of that. They had closed it off. So now I go, holy mackerel, I don't even know where I am again. So I was going through some beautiful parts of the county, but I had never been all the way up to the Cayentone Road, and that was pretty cool. So anyways, I hope everybody's high and dry now and that the floodwaters have receded, but wow. Crazy weather. Let's see here. Got a few other things I want to mention. Oh, you know, last week we had Bob Terryberry on the show. All right, everybody knows Bob. Bob's everywhere, and so he talked about his book, "Murder at Maple Springs." Now we were on our December 31st show. Chris, one of our folks here, our volunteers, was saying that one of his goals was to read 25 books. Well, guys, Bob gave me a copy of his book. I read it. And if you haven't had a chance to read this yet, I know it just came out, get a copy of it. Go out and buy yourself a book. You know, they're like $14, $15. But if you went to the movies, you're done in an hour and a half. This took me all week. I'll tell you, I loved it because I knew some of the characters that he was using that are people I've known over the years, but it all takes place right here in Chautauqua County. How cool is that? A murder mystery right here in Chautauqua County. Bob was twisting right along with the storyline, and I couldn't figure it out almost to the very end, and then I sort of think I got it, and then he threw a curveball at me. So anyways, great fun, great read, very exciting. So Murder at Maple Springs, Robert John Terryberry. Check it out. He's on Amazon and that. I don't normally promote books, but he was here last week, and he's a good friend, and I think it's well worth your effort. Okay. What else do I want to talk to you about? Lots of stuff here. Okay. Justin, I don't normally do this. You don't have to talk much, but my newspaper delivery man today, he made me a little crazy. So I have the newspaper here. Okay, I pulled it out of my mailbox. And Justin, can you do a little close-up on that? Okay, I just want everybody to see that. All right, right there. Very good. It says, I can't do this backwards, Saturday. All right, pull it out. No problem. I'm half asleep in the morning. Now, you might be looking at me. Okay, Justin, come over here for a minute. Come over here. I know you can do this. You don't have to worry about the shot. All I want you to do is read me the date that's on the rest of the newspaper right there, nice and loud. What does that say?
Sunday
what?
January 15th.
Thank you. So I'm looking through the paper and I'm going like, wait a minute, did I miss the show? It doesn't take much to get me crazy in the morning. I just lost my microphone here. But it was, somehow they must have taken the classifieds and added it to the Saturday morning paper. And I'm going like, oh my God, did I miss a whole day or something like that? So anyways, that's how my day started. I don't know about yours. So as far as I know, it is Saturday. But wow, that was crazy. So it must be they print some of those parts ahead of time, and then they deliver it. All right, enough with the fun and games here. Infinity, my good friends down there, Shane Hawkins and crew. They're going to hold a new story, a student orientation and intake session on Thursday, January 19th. That's this week coming up. Orientation sessions last approximately 30 minutes, including a tour of the Infinity Center and opportunities to meet with Infinity staff members and schedule lessons. Students must be registered for a session in advance as availability is limited. Private lesson students from Infinity Visual and Performing Arts will be putting on a recital at the Infinity Arts Cafe on Thursday, January 26th at 6 p.m. The event is free, family-friendly, and open to the public. Audience members of all ages are welcome. they really like alliteration. The free, friendly family, performance, pulse, poetry. I mean, they get these all this going in the, on Saturday morning, so I thought I did that rather well. For more information, give them a call, 664-0991. Or you can go to their website, infinityperformingarts.org. And folks, if you don't know anything about Infinity, you really should check it out. If you have young people in your family that are sitting around and they're getting like that zombie look on their face because they've been playing video games or they're working on their iPads all day, music, art, dance, theater, poetry, things I'm not even thinking about right now, fine arts. It's available, and kids are taking classes and are just loving life big time there. And I can't say enough about Infinity. I'll be working with my partner, Will Russell, and we're going to be doing Doc and Willie's Acoustic Cafe on March 3rd coming up. We're going to be doing sort of like a community get-together, and people can bring instruments and stuff like that. But I work along with these folks from time to time throughout the years, and just good stuff. And it's wholesome, and I encourage the kids to look into it. Okay, let's go to the Safety Village over in Asheville, just to remind you that if you're interested in having your son or daughter be a babysitter, or they want a first job, they can get certified. The Safety Village offers training for babysitting and helps the kids learn about first aid, CPR, and AED, and stuff like that. so that when your children are at home with a babysitter and you have one of the kids that goes through this program, you feel very confident they're going to be in good hands. I would have liked that sometimes for our kids. Okay, they also offer women's self-defense through the American Karate Association program in Asheville there. They also offer first aid, CPR, and AED through the American Heart Association for ages 12 through adults, and they'll actually come to your company, they'll come to your school, whatever. If you want to think safety, first thing you think of is the Children's Safety Education Village, and they're there for you. Okay, got some other announcements. This is from the Westfield Memorial Hospital. This is just to let you know, I'm going to kind of summarize this, that Kim Greiner, she's a certified diabetes educator, has an office at the hospital in Westfield, and she's there prepared to offer classes and discuss with you, if need be, various things about diabetes, pre-diabetes, type 2 diabetes. She's a pro in this area, and if you have any questions or concern about your medications or you want to know more about diabetes, you have a member in your family, give Kim a call at 793-2222. So again, 793-2222, and she's there Tuesdays or Thursdays, but this is a community outreach, and I'm amazed by how many people I know are diabetic and how many younger people are diabetic. Not only is it hereditary, but it's the way we're eating, our diet, the foods that we've been taking in the last 30, 40 years. It's different than it was 50 years ago. And for some reason, from what I read, I'm not a medical doctor, but it would appear that we're triggering a lot of this stuff from what we eat. Okay, so give Kim a call if you're interested. Let's see, another area of concern that I have that's a growing area is Alzheimer's. If you're interested, over at the Fredonia Place, one of my sponsors here, supporters, they have a free and confidential monthly support group for Alzheimer's and dementia caregivers, family members, and or residents there at Fredonia Place. The group is open to the general public and it's free. Beverages are provided. The meetings are held the third Thursday of every month at 4:30 in their Winter Garden Theater. So give them a call over there at Fredonia Place. I share this information because lots of times we don't know about these things. A lot of times we find out someone has just been diagnosed with diabetes, with Alzheimer's, whatever, cancer, whatever. And a lot of times it takes us a while to figure out how to maneuver through the systems in that. And these are there for you guys. It's free, so don't hesitate. Now, I mentioned caregivers. So often we worry about the person that has the affliction, but we forget about those that are taking care of that individual. So there's support for you out there as well. Okay, let's keep on going. My buddy's at the Veterans Services for the county. Good news, veterans, as of February 27th, we've been announcing this right along to get you ready for February, veterans will be able to save money on prescriptions through the VA healthcare. The VA is creating three tiers of co-pays. The tier one is $5 for a 30-day supply of preferred generic drugs. Tier two is $8 for a 30-day supply of non-preferred generic drugs over-the-counter medications. And tier three is $11 for a 30-day supply of brand name drugs. All traditional exemptions still apply. These changes only apply to veterans without service-connected disabilities. Now, if you have any questions, give the guys a call. They've been on the show here. You've seen them. They're friendly. They're nice. They help. I've talked to people that have been assisted by them many times. Give them a call at the Jamestown office, 661-8255, or the Dunkirk office, 268-6030. If you don't call, you don't get the service. You don't get the service. You don't get the benefit. You don't get the benefit. You get sick. Okay? It's real simple. Veterans, you did the job. You did what you said you're going to do. These guys are there to help you get your benefits that were promised to you when you got sworn in. Let's keep on going. Let's go up to Fredonia, Dunkirk area. The Northern Chautauqua Community Foundation has many grants and scholarships available. Until March 1st, letters of interest are being accepted for a community benefit grant program. Letters of interest must include a brief project description, the estimated number of people impacted by the project, and the amount of funding requested. Letters are not to exceed 2 pages. I tell you this because many of you belong to churches, clubs, organizations, Boy Scout troops, good doers. You have to be a 501c3 organization, I believe, so you got to be a community service organization type. But there's so many of you out there, and many of you are sitting in your meeting saying, boy, we could do this project if we had some funding, if we just had a little bit of money. These are the people that can help. So give them a call over there, and that's the Northern Chautauqua Community Foundation, Diane Hanneman Company. All right, this looks like a new one. I don't know if I've seen this one before. Until April 30th, this is from the Dunkirk Area Labor Council. It's currently accepting applications to its scholarship fund. Okay, so we all know somebody's going to school, college. If you were watching, you're in high school. These are the things you should be taking notes on right now. Graduating seniors interested in pursuing an education in the trades or manufacturing technology, such as an electrician, HVAC, pipe fitting, machinist, maintenance, auto tech, auto body, are encouraged to apply. Applications are available through your school districts, through BOCES and so on. Angola, Fredonia, Brockton, Cassadaga, Chautauqua, Lake, Dunkirk, Forestville, Fredonia, Pine Valley, Silver Creek, or Westfield. Okay, so they've got some grants available through the Dunkirk Area Labor Council, so check it out. Now, they tell me I have a poster now. I'm assuming this is the poster. It says here, thank you. May 1st, applications are being accepted for the newly announced Terrence J. Centner Agricultural and Environmental 4-H Scholarship, established for parents Harry E. and Mary Ellen Centner. They resided on the Centner Farm on Chestnut Road in the town of Dunkirk. They helped generation of 4-H'ers, including their children, Harry, or known as Bud, Terry and Jean, to enjoy a multitude of 4-H projects and activities. For more information on all of these grants and scholarships, oh, I see. So the Labor Council scholarship and the Centner scholarship are all through the Northern Community Foundation. So give them a call or go to nccfoundation.org and find out more information. So guys, money's available. Check it out. Okay, let's go over to Cassadaga. We bounce around here at the station. Cassadaga Job Corps Academy, Adam Dolson Company that were here not too long ago. They offer free career training for carpentry, painting, plumbing, electrical, and more. High school equivalency classes and testing, placement services, and more. If you're interested, give them a call at 595-4298 or go to cassadaga.jobcorps.gov and find out more information. Now, I share this with you because they were on the show. You might say, well, I don't remember what they said. Go back and go on the YouTube, put Chautauqua Sunrise, put Job Corps all in the search line, hit the button, look it up, and you can watch the show, and it's all good stuff. We're out there forever. We're like a big virtual library. Okay, let's see. I got just one more thing. Two more things. Okay, three more things. I want to remind you that the Winterfest is coming up here in February in Mayville. It'll be the weekend, I believe, 17th through like the 19th. Keep your eyes open for that, mark your calendars. And then we were talking a little bit about this. There's Open Door Day, January 21st in Jamestown. And I think we'll talk a little bit more about that later. But there's we were saying like 16 different organizations, free, no charge at the door. And so that's kind of a day that you might want to be looking at as far as something to do in Chautauqua County. And then one more time, if you haven't applied for your enhanced STAR benefits for homeowners, for your taxes, school tax, go down, apply with your local assessor at your town building, city hall, wherever, and you can get some pretty good money back. And save. You have to have an income of less than $86,000. You have to be 65. And other than that, check it out. Once again, we're here to tell you about this stuff, save you money, make you money, whatever. It's all good stuff. So I think I'm done with my announcements. So we're going to take a public service announcement, and we'll be right back. So stay tuned.
Hey, Gabby, how you doing? How's the play date and sleepover?
Dad, it was great.
Awesome. Okay, I'm on my way.
Hey, guys, what are you doing? I'll see you in a little bit, guys. I love you.
Hi, babe. How was school today?
Hi, Dad. It was great.
Okay, honey. I'll be home soon. Remember, you're never too far away from your kids to be a dad. Reach out and take a second to check in, because sometimes the smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life.
And welcome back. I am Doc Hamels. You're watching Chautauqua Sunrise, and we're so glad you joined us today. I was a school superintendent. A lot of people don't know that. And one of the things that was always on the front burner was transportation and sports. Okay? And I remember they told me that when I was taking my classes in administration. I go, well, I was at Bosse's. We didn't have a football team. The buses came to the center. I didn't deal with that. Wow, what a learning curve I had. Today we're going to talk about sports. We're going to talk about good stuff. We're going to talk about why sports are so important in our lives. But we're going to talk about some people that have been the cream of the cream, the cream of the crop. They've risen to the top. And I want to welcome today Randy Anderson, who's the president, let me get this right, of the Chautauqua Sports Hall of Fame. Did I get that right?
First try.
There is no county in there. I practiced that over and over again. And I just wanted to kick off right now, because I know he's in your Hall of Fame, but my dear, very good, dear friend, and where are you? There he comes. This was in the paper, but this guy is just an incredible guy. My buddy Mel Swanson. Okay, I'm getting this all goofed up here. But he broke 600 games of, there we go, Mel Swanson and his team. You can back it up a little bit, maybe. That was in the paper. But I have a feeling that the Sports Hall of Fame has something to do with recognizing people when they do good stuff.
Mel Swanson was an inductee of the Sports Hall of Fame, I believe, in 2015.
Right? Yeah.
Mel won his 600th girls basketball game this week.
That's a lot.
We're only talking about girls varsity, Doc.
That doesn't include
all. If you add in the boys varsity and right. The JVs and the modified, you know, Mel has coached everything out to Sherman. He's got well over 1,000 victories.
Oh my gosh!
But right now, with 600 wins in girls varsity basketball, I think, if I've got this right, I think he's third all time in New York State history.
And he's still going.
Well, he is going to retire this year.
Oh, sure he is. He told me that. He said, when I retire from teaching, you know, I'm going to do the AD and the ninth. And then there was one year, remember, he coached both boys and girls.
Oh, that's when Frank Wasslink died. Mm-hmm. Frank was the boys' right. coach at right. Sherman. He passed away, unfortunately, at a very young age, and Mel took over both teams. Not only do we have Mel in our Chautauqua Sports Hall of Fame, but we also have his son, Nolan. who was a graduate of Sherman. He went on to Wake Forest. He was a tremendous runner.
Do you know how he got his start? He ran against my son. who did not become an All-American runner.
Well, yeah, that's the...
Scott, I think, was a sophomore, and Nolan was a freshman, and this is a true story. They were running cross-country, and and Scott says the only reason he beat Nolan that one and only time was because Nolan lost a shoe somewhere. and Nolan finished the race with one shoe or something crazy.
It had to have been a lost shoe or a broken leg, Nolan, because Nolan was at the top of the world for running.
That's a true family story. And we Mel is my pinochle partner. We play against our wives. And in order to save both our marriages, we've stopped playing pinochle. But we digress. Randy, we were talking a bit about yourself earlier. Tell us a little bit about yourself. I don't know if everybody knows you, and maybe they don't want to know you, but I think they do.
I'm a lifelong resident of Chautauqua County. Mm-hmm. I graduated from Jamestown High School, SUNY Fredonia. I worked as a school teacher in the Jamestown Public Schools for 33 years. And after I retired from teaching school, then I switched my interests over to the Chautauqua Sports Hall of Fame, and I've been there since 2005 as a volunteer. No one gets paid at the Chautauqua Sports Hall of Fame, kind of like this place, Doc.
You get up every day because it's fun. You love it. Well, and that's what it's all about, you know. Yeah.
I coached girls soccer at Jamestown High School.
So how many wins did you have?
Not 600.
And soccer really wasn't that popular for all those years either. I mean, it was, you know, soccer's a relatively new sport compared to basketball and football.
We had so much fun, though. It was a great opportunity for me. I taught third grade, so mm-hmm. I worked with young students during the day. But then at the end of the day, I could go down to the high school and work with older students.
And see some of your former students, probably.
Exactly. It was a perfect scenario for me, and I'm so thankful for the opportunity. Yeah.
So you were a teacher, a coach. So how in the world did you get involved with this? I mean, you were coaching, but yes. I mean, this is big stuff. This is like national level stuff. I mean, this is not.
I've always had an interest in sports.
Did you play sports in school?
I did.
What did you do?
Basketball was the sport that I loved the most. Mm-hmm. I also have a huge interest in stock car racing.
Okay.
I was involved with a stock car team at State Line Speedway
and
other places.
And they're making a
left.
And another left.
So,
very exciting, I might add.
Well, here's how this is interesting, Doc, how I first got involved with the Sports Hall of Fame. I had nominated someone for possible induction. And ultimately, that person did get induction. It was the race car driver, Bobby Schnars. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, but perhaps the guys that were involved at the Sports Hall of Fame liked the nomination that I submitted and thought maybe I had something to offer. And they talked me into becoming part of the organization. And once I got in there, I really felt at home. And I said, this is something I can do. Make a difference and give back to the county.
Well, that's terrific. So let's talk a little bit about the history of the place and how it was founded. We were talking, it goes back quite a few years now, right?
It was founded in December of 1980. So that's 36 years ago, roughly. Mm-hmm. A couple of the principals that were involved in the formation of the Hall of Fame were Russ Dietrich.
I know Russ, sure.
The late Jim Riggs, mm-hmm. sports editor mm-hmm. The Post-Journal. Tony Milliato. Guys of that era, Tony Milliato owned U.S. News. He was a big sports guy.
Okay.
So anyway, it was just a bunch of local guys that got together and said, hey, we ought to do something in Chautauqua County to honor the great sports history of our county.
Was there any particular individuals that they felt hadn't been recognized for what they were? In other words, was there anything specific that was pushing them to do this? In other words, you know, everybody has a cause, and there's a reason for that cause. I mean, it had to be a little bit more than just, hey, you know, this would be really cool to do this. I mean, was it like, we got good people here too, and you know, they're not being recognized?
Well, I'm not sure of the genesis of it because I wasn't a part of it back then. But I do know that in the 50s, in the 1950s, there was a Jamestown Sports Hall of Fame that was started by Frank Hyde, who was the sports editor at the Post-Journal before Jim Riggs, and also the Jamestown Chamber of Commerce. So they formed a Jamestown Sports Hall of Fame, and that went in through the 50s, and then it kind of petered out. And I think it was Russ Dietrich, who was a member, an inductee of the Jamestown Sports Hall of Fame, who revived the idea and said, let's take it not just from Jamestown, but let's go countywide.
I got a funny story about Russ. I've run into Russ over the years in different organizations and stuff. And so we were at a Jammers game one time. I'm looking at this round, and I'm sitting behind, I think it was behind home plate. And I see this little sign that said, seat belongs to Russ Dietrich or something like that. So I sat in it. So just for a minute. So I ran into Russ and I said, "Wow, it's pretty cool. You have your own seat there." And I tried it out. And he said, "You try it anytime you want if I'm not in it." So it was
well, as you know, Doc. Not only does Russ have his own seat, but he has now the whole stadium. Russell E. Dietrich Jr. Right. Park Stadium.
Yeah, I noticed. I noticed that when I drove by there, JC.
So now you can sit in all the seats in the stadium, and they all belong to Russ.
They all belong to Russ. That's such a nice tribute to him. I know he's been a mover and shaker in that whole area in sports. Okay, so, boy, this I looked at your website, and I thought, how are we going to approach this topic? Because it's pretty big. Because there's a lot of stuff going on here. Let's just talk for a second, because we've both been in education. What's your read on sports and school? I mean, schools are constantly being pressured to cut, and trim, and so forth. We see teams are being blended and merged with other schools. People find it difficult to finance some of the sports. Sports Hall of Fame, you know, we're saying this is important, but how do you see it today?
Sports is critical. It's an important component of the total education of a student. A student has to be educated in the books, in the classroom, but the student also has to be exposed to sports, art, music, all the extracurriculars. It's the total package, Doc. It's not just sports. It's not just what's happening in the four walls of the classroom. It's the total package. And we have a great history of success in our county with our schools in the sports programs, the music programs, the arts, and obviously the education. So I'm a big fan of sports. If we don't have sports in our schools, I think we're really missing something.
Yeah. People might be thinking, well, okay, Doc, what did you do in sports? You know. Well, I like playing intramurals. In high school, you always, you know, you had your group against this group and that sort of thing. So I liked to play volleyball because I was tall. I was in sophomore class, and my coach, he says to me, Hamels, yes, sir. He said, report to the field tomorrow at 1 o'clock, at 3 o'clock. I go, what in the world does he want with me? Well, it turns out he was drafting people for cross country. We just talked about Nolan Swanson.
We were.
All right. Nolan has a different body shape than I do.
Still does.
Still does. I'm not saying that he's a shrimp or anything like that. I mean, he's not. He's well-built machine, all right? You look at his muscles, his body structure, he's like this. I'm not like that. And so I ran cross country that year. It about killed me. I got everything you can imagine that you can get in cross country with shin splints and everything else. But my famous motto was that year, don't let the bus leave without me. Everybody else was done and finished, up the hill, up Suicide Hill over in Delaware Park, and here comes Hamels at the very end.
Run to the bus.
So I always told the second last guy, I'm still on my way. Don't leave me. But I ran track, did the quarter mile. I thought, quarter mile will be fun because it's short. I was running whatever it was, the 2.5 miles. So dumb. Quarter mile is not an easy thing to do. It was like, ready, set, go. It's the longest dash I think they had at the time.
Yeah, I think it's considered a sprint event now.
So I did that one season. So then I went out for cross country the second year, and I just said, this is terrible. I'm not getting any faster. So I ended up being a manager. But nonetheless, I ran with some phenomenal athletes, and I learned team spirit. And even though I was always last, you know what? They always did cheer me through, you know?
Well, that's what sports offers. It's the team. It's working cooperatively toward a goal. It's overcoming adversity. Sports isn't all success, Doc. We're talking about Mel Swanson, a guy who's won 600 wins, but how many has he lost?
Right.
I mean, hundreds of games he's lost.
Yeah.
That's the value of sports to our students. It teaches them life lessons.
And balance, you know, to look at the world.
Exactly.
You know, you don't get smug about winning, and you don't, do the old Harry Carey thing with the sword and kill yourself because you lost. You got to find that balance.
And there's good days, and there's bad days, and you got to put the bad days behind you and put your best foot forward and get on to the next day. And I think that's what sports teaches.
All right, so we've talked about sports in school and that this had been something in Jamestown back in the 50s. So 1980, these guys get together, they form this idea. So it must have taken some time for this, the ferment, to grow and so forth. So let's fast track it to 2017 now. You were here on the show last year, just about a year ago.
Yes.
And you did a little piece about introducing what was going on that year and some inductees and stuff. But let's talk about bricks and mortar, location, what people can experience with the Hall of Fame. What's it all about?
The Sports Hall of Fame is located on 3rd Street in Jamestown, okay. 15 West 3rd. I like to tell people we're on the 50-yard line of downtown Jamestown.
Right.
We're kind of kitty-corner from the Lucy Desi Museum.
Okay.
For old guys like you and me, we're located in the old Carnahan's building on 3rd Street.
Okay.
We have a 4,000...
There it is.
That's us.
There you are.
We have a 4,000 square foot exhibition area.
4,000 square feet.
4,000 square feet. We are open Monday through Friday, noon to 3.
Mm-hmm.
We're staffed totally by volunteers. Some of them are from our own board of directors, and some are from community folks who just like to give back and help us out. What you will find within our brick and mortar walls down there is just an unbelievable collection of the sports history of our county. If you can name a sport, and we've probably got something from that sport. Our mission is to honor and preserve the sports history of our county.
Of our county?
Of our county only.
Okay.
Now, we honor athletes by inducting them into our Hall of Honor, which we'll talk about shortly,
mm-hmm.
but then we also preserve the sports history through donations that we receive. So if you want to know about, you know, what happened at Jamestown High School in a basketball game in the 1930s, there's a chance we might have a scorebook. Or what happened at Dunkirk High School in the 1980 with their football team. We're likely to have something from that.
So do you accept...
Donation? That's how we build our collection.
Okay.
We accept I like to say we're everybody's attic.
Mm-hmm.
And this, one of the ways we receive donations is a parent, a grandparent, someone will pass away. And the children are now in charge of cleaning out that person's home. And they start going through things in the attic, in the basement. And they find sports-related items. And fortunately, we've built some credibility and some notoriety that we will take care of those sports
items. Okay, you're good
items.
Stewards.
We're good stewards. We're curators. Mm-hmm. We preserve things. We have a database. So you bring something to us.
Wow.
We catalog it. We give it a number.
Mm-hmm.
We assign it a location so that in the future, someone comes in and says, hey, my dad was John Johnson. He played in the 1930s for Faulkner. Mm-hmm. Well, we've got a searchable database. Do we have anything on John Johnson from Faulkner in the 1930s? So we take this mission seriously,
very
Doc.
Nice, very nice. You know, we're talking about brick and mortars. You're located on 3rd Street, and we mentioned January 21. What's going on?
It's actually, January 21. Oh, you caught me off guard. January 21 is Open Doors Jamestown.
Did we say we were going to talk about
that? Oh, yes. You prepped me, but I wasn't thinking.
Work with me here.
It's early on a Saturday morning, Doc. Okay. Open Doors Jamestown is January 21st.
Right.
And that's a day where 16 attractors from the Jamestown area. It's not only downtown Jamestown, it's the Jamestown area. We work together to be open from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. on a Saturday.
There you go, right there.
It's absolutely free admission at mm-hmm. all the attractors. I should just mention the Sports Hall of Fame is always free.
Mm-hmm.
But all the other attractors have free admission that day. It's a wonderful opportunity to take your kids out, expose them to what's available into the community. It's also even older folks who maybe haven't been out and seen what's in their community. What's new, what's going on. It's absolutely free. It's a fun day. You can come down, you can see a few places, maybe take a lunch downtown at one of the local restaurants.
Why not?
Spend the rest of the afternoon at some of the other locations. Yeah. I mean, we're talking about the Lucy Desi Museum, Roger Torrey Peterson Institute, the Audubon Center, mm-hmm. Fenton Historical Society, the Reg Linnae, mm-hmm. the Northwest Bank Arena. Those are just some of the attractors right in my little area on mm-hmm. 3rd Street.
So a good day to get out and, you know, and appreciate, you know, I don't know about you, but I've been feeling like a real funk has been all over us for quite a while lately with the news and stuff like that. And this is sort of a day you can shake that off a little bit and get out and just kind of relax and appreciate things.
What's fun for us is that we see people that we don't always see. You know, mm-hmm. it's a real community event. We have more people come through our doors on door open Saturday than we do the rest of the year. Combined, probably. We have hundreds of people that show up on Doors Open Saturday. So you're shaking hands, you're slapping people on, and you're telling stories. They're coming in and they're looking at a picture that we have on the wall. They go, I remember that guy. He was my gym teacher. And then you hear a story.
It's
wonderful.
Yeah. Well, and that's what it's all about. All right. So what supports the Hall of Fame? I'm well aware that it costs money to heat the place and keep the lights on.
Exactly. As I mentioned, we're an all-volunteer outfit, mm-hmm. but we still have rent and utilities, insurance, things like that. We are supported by the community. We sell memberships. Mm-hmm. We sell an annual membership that costs just $30.
Cheap.
And we send out a monthly newsletter. Mm-hmm. And there's some other benefits attached to that. So that's one source of income. The second source of income is our biggest source, and that's our annual induction banquet, which is coming up on February 20th. Mm-hmm. And we earn money at that banquet through ticket sales mm-hmm. and through an induction dinner program book that we put together and sell advertising in.
Very good. And let's make sure we'll get back to that before we're done here. Where was I going to go with this? So you're a 501c3?
We are.
So it's tax deductible, or people can use it on their taxes, and that's all good stuff.
We have an endowment fund.
Okay.
And we had a very successful endowment campaign this year. And because we're a 501c3, there are tax benefits
Absolutely.
To donating to us.
Great. Okay, so one of the other things we were going to talk about today were the classifications of sports, and I know it's probably a long list, but I think it bears sharing right now. Do you have the categories with you, or go through the majority of them?
Well, I'd like to talk about the class of 2017.
That probably will get us started.
That we're going to be inducting on February 20th we'll talk about what sports they made their name in.
Let's do it.
Okay, so the class of 2017 will be inducted at our annual induction.
And where's that going to be?
It's going to be at the Lakewood Rod and Gun Club on February 20th. The hospitality hour starts at 5, and the dinner starts at 6:15, and the program follows directly after that.
Right.
Our class of 2017 includes Paul Cooley.
Well, tell you what, let's pop up pictures.
Let's see a picture of Paul Cooley.
Is that Paul?
No, that's Charlie LaDuca. We'll talk about Charlie LaDuca. Charlie LaDuca is a resident of Fredonia, but he made his props at Pine Valley.
Uh-huh.
He was a baseball coach at Pine Valley. He won a state championship when he was at Pine Valley. Just a tremendous baseball player himself and a tremendous baseball coach.
Now, do you have a certain criteria for these people to be inducted?
Yes, you have to have been either born in Chautauqua County, a resident of Chautauqua County, or participated in sports in Chautauqua County.
Okay.
So it's a pretty broad classification. And then after that, we receive nominations from the public. So we don't really go out and solicit nominations.
All right. That makes sense.
Let's say you've got somebody that is in your mind that you think perhaps belongs in. We have a nomination form. I can help you walk through the steps. And then the nomination is submitted. And then once a year, our 30-member board goes through all the nominations, and by the way, there are currently more than 100 on file. So we sift our way through that list of nominations, and we make the selections for that year.
And that committee has metrics they use as far
as,
you know,
things that are important to us are lifetime involvement in sport.
So just they didn't win a medal or something.
No.
It's more than that.
We're looking for people that were active in sports in high school.
Mm-hmm.
And then continue to be active in sports after high school. Either they went to college and were active in sports, or they were active in sports without going to college. Maybe they were coaches, referees, volunteers, people who gave back. So we're looking for people who were involved in sports over a entire lifetime.
And it's some aspect of sport. It doesn't have to be the athlete himself, it sounds like.
Oh, gosh, no.
Right.
Oh, we have many coaches. We have referees. We have sports historians. We cover the gamut.
All right, let's keep going. Let's pop up another picture.
Oh, that's Dave Paul Ketty. Dave Paul Ketty was a teacher at Fredonia Central. He made his name in the world of sports as the girls' softball coach at Fredonia and the boys' basketball coach at Fredonia. He won state championships in both sports.
Wow! Look at his focus. He looks like a coach. He looks like determination.
David is a graduate of Dunkirk High School.
Mm-hmm.
I mentioned that he worked at Fredonia Central. He's also a graduate of Jamestown Community College and SUNY Fredonia. So he's a real county guy.
All right.
That's what we're looking for.
So there was a coach. Okay, let's pop up the next one.
This is Deb Palmer.
I don't know Deb.
Deb Palmer was a phys ed teacher at Panama Central.
Okay.
She made her props in the sports of softball and volleyball.
Okay.
As we know, the Panama Lady Panthers just won the New York State Class D Volleyball Championship, and they will give credit to Deb Palmer for laying the groundwork that brought them to the standard they are today.
I know when Ripley would be playing, it was very competitive in many years. Panama was always the tough team to beat.
Yes.
Know. Okay, next.
That's Jake Ensign. Jake Ensign is a world-class bow hunter.
Bow hunter?
Bow hunter.
Okay.
He has achieved the North American Grand Slam of archery. That is, he has harvested all 29 big game animals on the North American continent. He's one of less than 20 people in the world to accomplish that achievement.
He's from Chautauqua County.
Lives in Bustai.
What do you know? How would you know that? You wouldn't know that.
Graduate of Westfield Central.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
All right,
Westfield Central.
Yeah.
All right. Jake, in his earlier days, owned a set of pharmacies called the Medicine Shop.
Oh, I'm familiar with that.
There you go.
All right, next.
That is Maceo Wolford. He's wearing the white jersey.
Now that name's familiar, but
Maceo Wolford was a graduate of Jamestown High School. He went from Jamestown High to Division I Iona College.
Okay.
Maceo is the leading scorer in the history of Chautauqua County basketball.
Wow.
2,300 and some points. A number that might never be broken.
I hear he broke your record.
The first game. First quarter.
First quarter. Wow, look at him go.
That's he's the real deal.
For those of you listening to this show on the radio, it's a shame that you can't see some of these pictures. But I tell you right now, if you go on on your Facebook site, you can see these pictures, I'm sure. Okay, keep going.
That is Mike Sayers. Mike Sayers.
Mike Sayers? Oh,
you know Mike?
God, I work with Mike.
He's a BOCES guy.
Oh, yes. All right,
okay, Mike.
Oh, let's beat Mike up.
Okay, pick on Mike Day.
Pick on Mike Day.
Mike is a graduate of Fredonia Central.
Yes, he is.
And then he went to Brockport, and he worked at BOCES as a phys ed guy forever and ever.
He and I worked together for a long time.
But Mike made his name in the world of sports in track and field.
In the Empire Games.
He's won so many Empire State Game medals.
Javelin
for javelin, yeah. Discus.
Yep.
Javelin, discus, and hammer.
Hammer?
Yeah. Anyway, right now, you're going to be stunned. Right now, Mike is the number one ranked javelin thrower in the world in the age group 60 to 65.
Mike Sayers.
Mike Sayers.
Little Mike.
Little Mike
little
is the
Mike.
Best javelin thrower in the world today. Today.
Wow. Mike truly is a great athlete.
And he's a great coach, as you know.
He's a lot of fun. He's a great sense of humor.
Yeah.
Okay. Wow.
Who else?
Good on you, Mike.
That is Paul Cooley.
Okay.
Paul Cooley is a resident of Gary, New York.
Okay.
He taught at Casadega Valley for many years. He was a basketball referee for over 50 years.
Hated by many. I've never met a ref that was ever loved.
He was a softball coach at Casadega Valley, a very successful softball coach. He has been involved with the Gary Rodeo for, there's another sport, how
there
about that?
Yeah.
For over 60 years, he's been involved at the Gary Rodeo. Paul is a beloved man in the community of Gary.
Wonderful, wonderful. You know, and that's so much of this we're talking about is not just the sport, but it's the whole person. You know, what they give back to the community.
We talked about the lifetime involvement in sports, and every lady, every guy we just mentioned has
still
a lifetime.
Still going. Okay.
Who else we got? Oh, you'll love that. Number 52. Number 52.
All right, for those on the radio, right now I'm looking at a football player standing next to an Indian or someone that's dressed like an Indian on a horse in a stadium. I have no idea what the story is behind this.
Oh, you're going to love it. The football player is number 52, Sam Restivo.
Oh, you see
the background is Florida State University.
Oh.
The mascot at Florida State is the Seminoles.
Yep.
So there's the Seminole Indian on his horse. Sam Restivo obviously played Division I football.
From Chautauqua County.
That's his, at Florida State. He's a graduate of Jamestown High School.
Right.
He was All-State, Class AA in Jamestown High School. And Wally Hucknall, the legendary football coach at Jamestown High, says that Sam Restivo was the best player he ever coached.
What was his position?
At Jamestown High, he was a running back and a linebacker. When he went to Florida State, he was a center.
Really?
A center.
He must have really bulked up. Well, wow, that's great. Oh, ooh, here we go.
That is Sammy Lamancuso.
Okay.
Sammy Lamancuso is a stock car driver.
Look at him in his uniform.
Oh, I know. Sammy is, I think he's 87 now.
Okay.
Sammy had a very successful driving career, but he continued to stay involved in the sport after he quit driving as a mentor to other drivers.
You know, that's huge, the mentoring part, you know.
Exactly.
You know, you look at football games and you see a lot of, well, Jim Kelly, for instance, you see him on the sidelines, but you see these guys, you know, helping out the younger guys coming up through.
So that's Sammy, raced in the 40s, the 50s, in the 60s, and the 70s.
Wow.
And then when he retired, he mentored the next generation. He's a grade A mechanic, so he helped guys build cars and so on.
Good for him.
Yeah, Sammy's a
is he still
great
active
guy.
Still helping
still if you go up to State Line Speedway on Saturday night, Sammy Lamancusa will be there.
Wow. Lifetime. Okay. Ah, we were talking about him earlier.
That is Doc Malinowski. And it's appropriate that we're doing the show today from the house that Doc built.
You got it.
The gymnasium at Mayville Central is the Doc Malinowski Gymnasium. Doc was the phys ed teacher and athletic director and coach of all the sports at Mayville Central for over 27 years. He was also the Lakeside Park, Mayville Lakeside Park Recreation Director for probably 30 years. Doc was God.
All the kids knew him.
Everybody knew him.
And Jeff Zook was saying he was in awe of the man.
Yeah, he's a legendary coach.
I've heard his name many times in the area. Okay. Are we done yet? Oh, no, there's more yet. Who's
that
this?
That is Bob Patterson.
Okay.
Bob Patterson is a graduate of Dunkirk High School. Mm-hmm. He was he was a tremendous high school athlete at Dunkirk High. I think he won 10 varsity letters in about 5 different sports. I mean, he was a guy that could play anything.
Yeah.
But he really made his name as the youth and the recreation director for the city of Dunkirk.
Okay.
So here's a guy, again, a lifetime involvement in sports with youth and old. We hear stories about Bob. He'll be sitting on a tractor at like 9:30 at night waiting for a softball game to end so that he can go out, mow the grass, prepare the infield for the next morning's game.
Right.
Bob Patterson is Mr. Sport in Dunkirk.
Okay, I was told that was the last of the pictures, and now I have a question that was posed to me earlier. Okay, you don't know this, but a bunch of us here, I'm just starting, but they're real involved with bicycling, cyclists. Mm. So how many cyclists do you have in the Hall of Fame?
None.
None. I'm American.
Now, we have some triathletes, you know.
All right.
Bicycle riding is a part of that.
You're good.
But I don't think we have any pure standalone cyclists.
We got to fix that, guys. All right.
Oh, so somebody's got to work on Doc's nomination here.
No, not mine. Don't worry. I'm too old for that. I'm just happy to stay on my bike. Listen, we're down about a minute and a half, and this has been so much fun. Will you come back next year?
Absolutely. Sign me up right
now.
Right, Let's get it done.
We'll get you in January next year, 2018.
I'm going to need a big pay increase next year, Doc. So you'll get the same rate as I do.
How's
perfect.
Okay,
sign me up.
So let's talk a little bit about your fundraiser, and then we got to get out of here.
Well, again, our big fundraiser is February 20th at the Lakewood Ride and Gun Club. Tickets are available at Matt's News in Dunkirk on 3rd Street. They're available at the Jock Shop in Jamestown on Harrison Street. They're available at the Chautauqua Sports Hall of Fame headquarters, also on 3rd Street in Jamestown.
You haven't told us what the carrot is. There's got to be some big name athlete or sports person going to be your speaker. Is this a secret?
We are not going to have a guest speaker this year. We are going to focus on our 11 inductees.
Okay.
And we're honoring 40 high school, collegiate, and community athletes.
Wow.
From around the county. So from virtually every school system will have someone there.
Wonderful.
It's a big day.
Wow. All right. With that, we got to get going here. So, Randy Anderson, president of the Chautauqua Sports Hall of Fame. Thank you for being my guest today.
You're the best, Doc.
I try. And folks, you've been watching Chautauqua Sunrise. We're going to do this all again next Saturday at 9 o'clock. And we're going to do this about a year from now with Randy again, talking about the inductees. You have a safe, dry, hopefully warmer weekend. And we'll see you next time right here at Access 5. Take care.